Good evening and welcome to our Greenwood Gospel Chapel February hug. And we're so glad that you're joining us. So welcome to one and all. And with that, I'm going to turn things over to Gary.
Down from his glory, ever living story, my God and Savior came. And Jesus was his name. Born in a manger, to his own a stranger, a man of sorrows, tears, and agony. What condescension, bringing us redemption, that in the dead of night, not one faint hope in sight. God gracious, tender, laid aside his splendor, stooping to woo, to win, to save my soul. Oh, how I love you, how I adore you. You're my breath, my sunshine. You're my all in all. Jesus, my creator, you became my savior, and all God's fullness dwelleth in you. Without reluctance, flesh and blood his substance, he took the form of man, revealed the hidden plan. Oh, glorious mystery, sacrifice of Calvary. And now I know you are the great I am. Oh, how I love you, how I adore you. You're my breath, my sunshine. You're my all in all. Jesus, my creator, you became my savior, and all God's fullness dwelleth in you. And all God's fullness dwelleth. Born in a manger in a stable in Bethlehem. What a way to begin the incarnation of the great I Am. Putting Mary's little baby in the center of the universal plan. For God so loved the world altogether, every boy, girl, woman, and man. At his heels when he came to earth, he tried to stop him one way or another from the time of his birth. Just when he thought he had succeeded, Jesus died upon the cross of Calvary, turning defeat into victory, restoring the family, the Father, the Savior, and me. Too many times we get discouraged, trying to fight battles that we can't win. Jesus said we ought to lay them all upon him. Heaven rejoices every time a lost child comes home. Don't you know there's a place in the kingdom for the ones who roam? you're looking for the answer, it was spoken long before this world began. For God so loved the world altogether, every boy, girl, woman, and man. If you're looking for the answer, it was spoken long before this world began. Christ died for sinners to turn us into winners, every boy, girl, woman, and man.
Welcome again to this lovely evening. I can't promise any hugs, but it's a nice sentiment. That last song was written by Gene McClellan, and many of you will know Gene McClellan as a very popular songwriter, wrote a number of songs, Snowbird, and especially Put Your Hand in the Hand of the Man Who Stills the Water. I got to know Gene over a number of years, and he's associated with Prince Edward Island, although he was not born there. But he wrote that last song. He called it Reunion. And I'm getting a bit ahead of myself here, but I just want to say this in honor and tribute to him. The night that Claudette and I were commended or committed to the Lord's work, which would be 40 years ago this coming August, I invited Gene to come and sing, and that is the song he sang. And he had me on the part when he sang The Great I Am. As soon as I heard that line, I thought, this is wonderful. I need to learn the song. So that's from Gene McClellan. Now, speaking of Prince Edward Island, I'm told that I was born on that island in 1950. I'm going to come back to that, because the story I'd like to tell this evening is not, it's not really about me, although it's going to include speaking about myself, unfortunately. But the purpose is, my purpose, our purpose at Greenwood Gospel Chapel, is to highlight, I'm going to give you some lowlights of my doing, but I do want to highlight many of God's mighty interventions in my family, which otherwise would have continued as a dysfunctional family headed for certain spiritual death. And it highlights the importance of how God can break in to what seems like a hopeless situation that's spiraling out of control and reverse the entire course, not only the eternal destiny of a family, but also the earthly time that the family spends. Now, I'd like to begin in the year 1930. I wasn't around then, of course, but in the year 1930, I'd like to tell you of a young 20-year-old farm girl on a farm, a dairy farm, on the Loyalist Road on Edward Island between Charlottetown and Hunter River. And she was one of six siblings. She had five brothers. And the five brothers were well known to be hard-working farmers. And they were also known to be hard rum drinkers and a formidable force after the rum when they went out looking for fights. So she grew up in this environment, and she was a Protestant as opposed to a Catholic. And why am I saying that? Because she developed a romantic relationship with a man who was a Catholic. And they fell in love. And she became pregnant with a child, but her family and his family did not allow them to get married because of the religious divide between Protestant and Catholic at that time. And that would not be perhaps as common the case now. But that little girl that was born to unwed parents was my mother. So Vera was my grandmother, who was not allowed to marry the love of her life, Charlie, on religious grounds. She gave birth to a little girl who was named Pearl. And that was my mother, and my mother was born in 1930 on Prince Edward Island. Well, because of the heartbreak that my grandmother suffered at not being allowed to marry, and because of the embarrassment of the circumstances, she didn't stick around very long. She took off and went to New York City, and she lived a pretty riotous life in New York. And I say that because I visited her there a number of times with her then husband. And also I was on the receiving end with my mother of phone calls that came years later. She was also very fond of the Manhattans or whatever it was she was drinking, but it was pretty heavy stuff, judging by some of the indications. She had a broken heart. She had regrets in her life, sorrows, things that she couldn't change, wishes had been different. And right here, we want to apply this because we're all in that boat, aren't we? Whoever you are here this evening, you have things in your life, in your past, skeletons rattling in your closet, things that you wish you could change, that you wish were different, things that you wish you hadn't said, hadn't done. So what happened to my mother with her mother off in New York? Well, my mother was bounced around from a Catholic orphanage in the United States to an aunt in Toronto, back to Prince Edward Island. And she came back to Prince Edward Island at 16 years of age to help care for her grandmother, whom she loved dearly. And eventually she met and married a chap named Elwood Weeks, my father. Now, that was the year 1950. And so my birth certificate tells me that I was born, and it's a Prince Edward Island birth certificate. It's only a piece of paper, but it says that I was born on May 22nd, 1950. I guess that's true. I'd like to think they made a mistake and I'm really only 42. But the reality is, what I'm saying is that I've never doubted this birth certificate. Have you ever doubted your birth certificate? When your birthday comes around, do you ever wonder, I wonder if I was really born on this day? I wonder if I really am this age? No, you likely have never done that. Why? Because you have taken the statement at its word. It's an official document. Hold that thought. We're going to come back to it. And so I was born, I came into this world in this farmhouse in Fredericton, Prince Edward Island, actually in this upper room. Born in that room, and my mother had moved in with my father into their family home, the farm there, and it was awkward from the beginning for a number of reasons. My other grandmother on my father's side, Ada, Vera was my mother's side, Ada is my father's side, she had had several miscarriages. She was getting on in years, and when my father was born, a son needed on the farm, she was very protective of him in the sense that she was concerned about him getting sick because they needed him on the farm. But she was also concerned when he got married because my mother was perceived as taking my father's affections away from his mother. So my mother and her mother-in-law were chafing from the very beginning. It wasn't going very well. I think my mother and father were getting on well, but my mother was told to stay in her room. And Granny Ada would say, stay in your room, Pearl. I'll call you when meals are ready. And so my mother concluded this was not her idea of marriage. And she suggested to my father that they leave, but he was reluctant to. He was pretty bound to his mother. And so on the advice, I think, of some friends, my mother, one night after she had left, she came back to visit, and in a real cloak and dagger operation, she and a girlfriend were visiting me while Granny Ada was pacing around the room nervous because Ben, my grandfather, was asleep and my father was out. And Ada knew something was up. And sure enough, at a certain moment, my mother and her friend grabbed me and out the door they went. And I'm told that Ada was roaring and cursing at them out the door as they drove down the lane. And so they went to an undisclosed location. I happen to know where it is now, but nobody knew then. And so Ada and my father didn't know where to go to find Pearl and Gary. I was 3 months old at the time. Now, remember that my mother, when she was born and all during her life, before she was married, she had never met her father. She had never seen her father. She knew her father's name was Charlie. She knew his last name and she knew his occupation. And so the night that I was taken at 3 months of age, my mother had gone to a lawyer in Toronto, in Charlottetown, and said to him, look, you know, I want custody of my son. What, how do I go about this? And the lawyer looked at her and he said, Pearl, I'm sorry, I can't help you, because he said, your husband's already been in to see me. And I'm told that he said to her, listen, he said, Prince Edward Island is in this province, the custody of the children goes to the father in a circumstance like this. But he said to her, off the record, I advise that you take Gary and get off Prince Edward Island. And so that's what she did. And so she had taken me, stayed overnight at another place, and the next day went to the airport in a taxi to take me away from Prince Edward Island and off to Toronto. And as she got to the airport, quite distraught, she looked up and noticed that the identification of the driver, the taxi driver driving her and me to the airport, was her father. Now, I asked her about this a number of times, but you know, everything in her wanted to tell him who she was and who I was, but she didn't. So she looked into his eyes as she paid the fare, and with a broken heart and crying all the way to Toronto with me, she landed in Toronto, and the year was 1950. In the following years, my mother wrote to my father seeking a divorce. She had a number of men friends. One in particular stole her heart. He was a man who was married. She was married. And he was 20 years her senior. And she moved in with him. And you might say, well, what happened to you? Well, I stayed with an aunt. I stayed with the aunt that my mother had stayed with when she was younger. And so my mother would come and go at times and visit, but essentially she was cohabitating with this other man. She was a geriatric nurse. She did a lot of nursing of elderly people on a sort of a overnight basis. And so she was looking through the Bible to see what the Bible said about divorce. And the Bible has quite a bit to say on that subject, but she was seeking the subject of divorce from the scriptures because she wanted a way out of her marriage in order to marry this other man. But as she was reading the Word of God, the Spirit of God, in all of his tenderness and power, convinced the wayward heart of Pearl Margaret Weeks that her husband wasn't the problem, her mother-in-law was not the problem. Her problem was her sin. And the Lord saved my mother. What do I mean by that? Well, he convinced her that she was unworthy of his forgiveness apart from putting her confidence in what Jesus Christ did for her, not what she might do for him. And that very night, she passed from death unto life, spiritually speaking. This is a copy of her personal story. It's called I Only Wanted to Love and Be Loved. And here's what she says, and I'd like to read it because it's in her own words. She said, immediately, I knew I had to break away from the relationship I was in. She was 25, the man was 45. That very night, listen carefully, that very night, I left the man I loved. So here she was, 25 years of age, with a life of trauma and dysfunction. She only wanted to love and be loved. And she thought that this man was the means of providing the love her heart was seeking. Instead, she said, my friends thought I had lost my mind, and they tried to have me see a psychiatrist. I replied that I had indeed finally found the only one who could set my life straight and give me a real purpose for living. I had found perfect peace in Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace. This is where God intervened in mighty power that night in that elderly woman's room as my mother was caring for her overnight and reading the Bible. She wasn't seeking God. She wasn't looking for Jesus. She was looking for a way out of her marriage. But the word of God is quick and powerful and spoke to her heart and won her. And I can tell you this, I remember it very well, because my life changed when her life changed. It's called repentance. Everything changed. That very night she left the man she loved. Can you imagine the heartbreak? More heartbreak upon heartbreak. I said to her a number of times, I said, what was it like, Mom, when you left there, when you packed your stuff and you moved out, and you walked out of that house from Jack? She said, my heart was broken and Jack was weeping like a baby. See, this is the world we live in, the world of pain and suffering and sorrow. But God intervened and turned everything around in our lives. And that's the reason I'm here before you this evening. It's not because I'm some kind of hotshot anything. Not at all. It's because that night on March the 1st, 1950, God intervened and saved the soul of Pearl Weeks. My life changed. Her life changed. And I told a man downtown Toronto a few weeks ago, Christian fella, I said, the best thing my mother ever did for me was to trust the Lord Jesus. She gave me birth, gave me life. Yes, that's true. That's all wonderful. But the best thing she ever did for me was to trust the Lord Jesus Christ. She came to the cross, and there's a hymn called Room at the Cross. And I think it's time for each of us to now turn our attention back to the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who loved us and gave himself for us on that middle cross.
The cross upon which Jesus died is a shelter in which we can hide. It's grace so free, sufficient for me, and deep is its fountain, as wide as the sea. There's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross. Sinner, before it's too late, there's room at the cross for you. Yes, there's room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. Yes, there's room at the cross for you. The hand of my Savior is strong, and the love of my Savior is long. Through sunshine or rain, through loss or in gain, the blood flows from Calvary to cleanse every stain. There's room at the cross for you. Yes, there's room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. Yes, there's room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. Yes, there's room at the cross for you. Are you still reaching for the sky? Trying every way to fly, falling with every tear you cry. Well, Jesus is the way. Makes no difference where you've been or how deep you're into sin. Is there an emptiness within? Is Jesus calling you? Taste and see the Lord is good. He never fails, he never could. Turn from your sin, you know you should. Jesus is the only way. So taste and see the Lord is good. He loves you like no other could. He'll save your soul, he said he would. Because he's the only way. Makes no difference, don't you see? He calls to you and he calls to me. Came to set the captives free, because he's the only way. The way, he's the only way. But they hung him on a tree. He took the place of you and me. Jesus alone can set you free, because he's the only way. So taste and see the Lord is good. He never fails, he never could. Turn from your sin, you know you should. Jesus is the only way. You like no other could. He'll save your soul, he said he would. Because he's the only way. The way, he's the only way.
We may have some Prince Edward Islanders on board with us here this evening, and you may recognize that song. It was written by Islander Margie Reno, good friend of Gene McClellan's. Lovely song, caught my attention first time I heard it. Jesus is the only way. Now, you say, well, what happened after that? You know, you're 5 years of age. Your mother is now a Christian. She's left the man she loved. Well, we began to attend a small church. It was a Eglinton Avenue Gospel Hall. And little did I realize that that would be a place, not the place, but the people, that would have a deep and profound influence upon my life, because I write in my own little story here, True Love at Last, picture of a ship on the front there, which will become more evident as we proceed. But I write that soon after my mom became a Christian, we began to attend Eglinton Avenue Gospel Hall. There, I was genuinely loved and faithfully taught from the scriptures how I could be saved from the hell I did deserve and sure of the heaven I did not deserve. And even though I, at this point, 5 years of age, had no recollection of seeing my father, I felt in a way like I had five or six fathers, at least three or four. The men in that assembly, in that church, were just wonderful. They influenced me tremendously, and some of them are still with us. I note with affection Dr. Ted Kay, who's with us at Markham. His wife Eunice was my first Sunday school teacher when I was a wild and woolly six-year-old. She was my first Sunday school teacher, trying to teach me about the things of God while I was there disrupting the class, doing Elvis Presley impersonations of "You Ain't Nothing But a Hound Dog." And I kind of remember that with embarrassment. But again, it was God intervening in my life, which was directionless before that. But after my mom became a Christian and we began attending the assembly there, there was the fellowship of the Christians. Now, I wasn't a Christian at 5 years of age. Some people like to think they're born Christians. Well, that's not true. Or born sinners. And it wasn't until I was 12 years of age at a summer camp, a Christian camp, where a man was, he was going on about the love of God. And I had heard a whole lot about the love of God. And I'd heard some about the wrath of God too. I think it's always important to keep a balance, isn't it? The love of God, the wrath of God. They're all part of who God is. And so I was hearing the truth of God and my need of a savior. I had told some lies a couple of years before and pretended I was a Christian, and everybody there thought I was already a Christian too, so I could avoid the heat of maybe somebody trying to preach at me. But this man wasn't trying to preach at me. His nickname was Ozzy because he was from Australia. But I do remember him very warmly and tenderly speaking about the love of God. And I was sitting on a rock and I had a stick and I was gouging out, you know, just doodling with the stick in the dirt. And I mean, all of a sudden, with no warning whatsoever, just like my mother was not seeking God, I wasn't seeking God. I was a 12-year-old wild Indian. Maybe I should rephrase that. Wild person. And all of a sudden, I became very aware that I was centered out. And I remember looking around at the other campers. The campfire was going. It was about 9:15 in the evening. So it was getting dark and the campfire is going and Ozzy's talking away. And I remember looking around, wondering why everybody was looking at me, and nobody was looking at me. That was really quite a surprise. So, well, why do I feel centered out? Now, I'm not wanting to put words in God's mouth, but the thought was clearly communicated to my young heart. These people think you're a Christian, but I know you're not. Ouch. In a moment of time, I realized God is speaking to me. How did I know it was God? Because he was coming to me on the issue of sin. What sin? Lying? Worse than that, he was coming to me on the issue of a specific lie that nobody else there knew about. And I realized in a moment of time, the only person who could be saying this to my soul was God himself. Now, I knew how to be saved. I knew I was a sinner. That was not a problem. And I knew that Christ died for the ungodly I knew I was ungodly. I would have agreed with that. And in a moment of time, I found myself in my soul, in my inner man, just casting myself upon Jesus and what he has done for me. My first thought was to run and hide. But where are you going to run and hide from someone who knows the worst about you and comes and tells you about it? And just as quickly as I felt the frantic panic of wanting to hide, because I was found out, kind of like Adam, you know, Adam, where are you? This was my Gary, where are you moment. God knew exactly where I was. And he knew exactly what to say to my heart to convince me of my sin and of his righteousness and of judgment without the Lord Jesus as my Savior. Well, things changed in my soul, not overnight, before the night. I was witnessing to the kids in my camp and the counselor that night. Things went on through the teen years, and because of the affiliation at Eglinton Gospel Hall, I developed, the Lord developed in me a real interest and hunger for the scriptures to not only to understand them, but I was amazed at what the Bible said. It seemed to touch every conceivable aspect of life, even as a teenager. And my teenage years were very busy. Hockey teams, baseball teams, swim team, 3 part-time jobs. And once in a while, school got fit in there somewhere along the way. I like to tell people I had 6 wonderful years at North Toronto Collegiate. And that's when the old timers will know that's back when we had 5 years. Well, I had 6 wonderful years. And the reason is that the night before my final English exam, I thought, well, I better read the book that the exam tomorrow is on. And it was a book called Eagle of the Ninth. I had no idea what it was about. And I was sleeping out of my tent in the backyard, as I did in the summer months for probably 3 months at a time. And I had the flashlight and I opened the book and I thought, oh, you gotta love the smell of that ink. And I read the preface in the back and my mom called me, Gary, telephone, it's your coach. And it was the hockey coach wanting to discuss training program for the summer. Well, I put the book down, went in, was on the phone. I say I was on the phone for 2 hours. My mom says I was 3 hours. In any case, I didn't read the book. Now, I don't know how to say this, but I thought it was pretty impressive that I got 36% writing an essay on a book I'd never read. I don't know what that's saying about me, but what it says is that if you don't read the book, you fail. And listen, if you don't read the Word of God, you're going to fail in life and you're going to fail in eternity. And as death finds you, eternity will hold you. What you do with the Lord Jesus in time determines what he does with you in eternity. You need to read the book. Don't open the Bible and smell the ink. Read it, because that is where God will speak to your heart. Well, eventually I ended up going off to university with my good friend Dave. And we wanted to be airline pilots. That's really the main interest we had. But we thought, well, we have to go to university because Air Canada chief pilot was saying, you need to get a degree because if your medical goes sour, then you can fly a desk. Well, so away we went to university, and I was a full-time university student, full-time flight student, and singing at night between 9 p.m. and 1 a.m. in the morning to pay for the flying lessons. Life got very busy, very hectic. And one thing led to another, and to make a long story short, Dave and I ended up going into some contests, and we did surprisingly well. There was one United Way contest. There were 500 entrants, and there were 11 finalists, and the finals were at Massey Hall, about 1968. I was about 18 or so. And Dave and I went out and we sang Living in the Love of the Common People by the Everly Brothers on this Massey Hall stage. And we came 4th out of 11 contestants in that thing. So that led to a recording contract. And we thought, well, maybe we can make something of this. And so then we went into making records, and the first record sold 240 43 copies, I think it was. So we were a long way from any kind of success. But I say unfortunately, because in a way I wish it had never happened. We had written a song that when it was recorded and when it was released, it just took off. And not just in Canada, but in other countries around the world, Australia especially, the States, Europe, South Africa, recorded in some other languages. But I want to renounce that song now because it's fake news. The song says, could you ever love me again if I let you down, disappointed you? Could you ever love me again if I cease to do? And it uses the word if four times in the chorus. And what it's doing is it's appealing to the, not the pain of love lost, but the anxiety associated with the fear of losing love in the future. What kind of love? Conditional love. If. As a Christian, I should have known better. I should have known better to never write, never record, never sing, never perform a song like that. And that's why I don't do that now, because the Lord has put a new song in my heart, even praise unto my God. But trying to juggle university and flying and a pursuit of an aviation career, that got very, very tricky in many ways. But we made it work. We had one foot in the music world and one foot in the aviation world. And we kind of liked that because we felt that one was a safety net for the other, so to speak. But the long and short of it was that after lots of interesting flying experiences, some which were quite terrifying, really, they say that aviation is, hours and hours of boredom punctuated by moments of stark terror. Well, that was about it. And I had some moments of stark terror and some good illustrations in there about faith about flying on instruments. You can't see the ground, you can't see the horizon. You have to trust those instruments. If you trust your inner ear in turbulence sloshing around, you get vertigo, you'll fly yourself into the ground. Some very good illustrations from aviation. But we were hired by Air Transit Canada, which was a subsidiary of Air Canada at the time. And I moved to Ottawa, Dave moved to Montreal. And we flew with that for a better part of 3 years. It was a fantastic experience for a lot of very nice technical cutting edge historical reasons, which I love to talk about. But the reality of it is that when it ended, Dave and I had to make a choice. First of all, Air Canada was going down our seniority list. There were 52 pilots. I was number 51 on the list. Dave was number 52. And they were going down the list and hiring the eligible pilots to take them into the mainline carrier. So we thought it was a matter of time. But it wasn't happening because there was a downturn in aviation, and it became evident that they were not going to get to my number. But eventually they said, well, come on in and do the course. So we went in and did the simulator course, but the course got canceled before it was finished. And that left us with another decision. Now what? We don't want to go up to the bush in the Arctic and flog around up there. So we decided to throw all of our emphasis into the music business. Throw, instead of one foot in one field, another foot in the other, we put all our eggs in the one basket, the music business. And that was that proved to be very, very timely in a number of ways, because by then there had been a lot of records released and there was a lot of airplay. We were well known and there was a large following across the country and down into the States, and we had already been to Japan. And so it looked like, oh, okay, well, maybe we'll put this whole airline thing on hold and see what we can milk this music business for. And it went pretty well for a couple of years. And at one point we were contacted by a gentleman who told us that we had been scouted. And he used the term scouted. He'd been watching us for some months, following us various places, And he was representing a very large, high-level management company in New York City. And you say, well, how large were they? Well, they owned the rights to the Godfather movie. And they showed us the room where they did the editing for the Godfather movies. And they took us by Al Pacino's office. These guys were the real, so all of a sudden we had kind of stars in the eyes and negotiating back and forth. And they had big plans. And we thought, well, I guess Canada, we've kind of conquered Canada. Well, now it's time to conquer the US, full of bravado and foolishness. And their plan was television. It was in the days of Donnie and Marie Osmond. And they envisioned us being a television entity. Well, I had done enough television by that time to hate it. It's dreadful because you have to be an actor. You're looking at the bottom of a Coke bottle, so to speak, and they're telling you there's X number of people watching. Meanwhile, you know, the cameraman's doing this in his ear and you're seeing reality. And you have to pretend. And I just found it very, very awkward and just did not like it at all. Well, there were three vice presidents in the company and two were really keen on us. The third one was the chief financial officer. We met him once for about 10 minutes and we had a very brief chat. Not much was said, but enough was said for him to recognize that I hated the whole idea of television and the whole direction that they wanted to take us. And I remember him looking at me. I didn't know why he was looking at me hesitatingly, soberly, not sternly, but very soberly. I remember him looking at me and it turned out that the big deal we'd been working on for 2 years, it fell flat overnight. In fact, in one conference phone call and it fell apart because he said, Weeks is not on board. And boy, when I heard that, my heart was broken because it was a big deal, but I knew he was absolutely right. And you know something? That was one of the worst days of my life. As I sat in Bay Street in the lawyer's office, listening to that edict, it's over. We can't get the third signature of the third vice president. So we can't proceed. It's a company policy. Sorry, guys, it's over. It's over. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. The lawyer and his secretary said, let's go across the street for lunch. I couldn't understand how they could eat. I sat there. I was so upset. I couldn't eat a thing. I thought my whole world had fallen apart. But you know what was happening? God was intervening again. God pulled that rug right out from underneath me. He closed the door to that whole part of the world. Who knows where that would have gone? Nowhere good, I'm quite sure. And that led to a real bout of depression. I don't even know how to describe it. You see, I had, even as a Christian, my self-worth, my sense of who I was, had shifted from being a child of God to being, oh, I'm a pop singer. I entertain people. I sing for money. The more the better. The more the merrier. And so when this whole world fell apart and the touring opportunities dried up because the Bee Gees came along with disco and all of a sudden we were the first to be unemployed because we were the highest paid touring act in Canada at the time. And so we were the first to go because why pay Gary and Dave a whole bunch of money when we can pay somebody to play records for $250 a night and still fill the place? And overnight, I found myself broke and brokenhearted. You say, well, why were you broke? Weren't you making money? Yes. But we had invested that money in another album that was about to be released. It was all recorded, all mixed, some good stuff on it. We had gotten control of our own recording and so on at the time, foolishly, I admit now looking back. And so it was a disaster, an absolute disaster from my perspective. But from God's perspective, he was turning things his way. And there came a time one night, I can't go into the details for the sake of time. And not just time. It's too tender to even relate. The Lord intervened again. And he brought me to my knees. And I said, Lord, what are you trying to say to me? And in loving kindness and tender mercies, he said to me what he said to Saul of Tarsus, arise, arise. You see, folks, God's way up is down. God had to draw me to my knees. He had to bring me to the end of myself in every way and remind me, arise, let's start over my way. Now that is mercy and grace. You talk about a loving, merciful, gracious God taking a wretched, proud, self-righteous, arrogant pop singer as I was and pulling all of that right out from underneath me and leaving me basically with nothing except him. And when I discovered by the shock that the Lord Jesus, who loved me and gave himself for me, he had never left me. I even said at one point, Lord, what are you doing here? I've never left. So I don't know who I'm speaking to tonight, except I'm speaking to the Lord. If you're a wayward Christian here tonight, I want to tell you this, you can run, but you cannot hide. The Lord Jesus, by his Spirit, follows you everywhere, and he knows exactly what buttons to push and when, to woo and to win you back to himself from whatever allurements, surprises, or pleasures have distracted you from him, and bring you back to looking unto Jesus, the one who will never leave you nor forsake you. This was a shock to me because I was singing about conditional love. If you love me, if, when, because. If you, and so all of a sudden the Lord crashed back into my life again with this weighty emphasis that his love was unconditional. Gary, I love you, period. And that cross is the evidence of it. And boy, I'll tell you, by the time I got up from my knees with tears streaming down my face, I wrote a song called You Call Me Son. I'm not going to sing it, wouldn't get through it. But I have another song for you. It's a song that speaks about the love of God, the Word of God. I've entitled it, Your Love Keeps Me Alive. I didn't write the music, but I've reworked the words. You might recognize the tune. The Eagles did it some years ago in the 90s. But it plays out the sentiment that was going through my heart that night when the Lord Jesus drew me to my knees and then said, arise. God's way up is down, and his love keeps me alive to this day.
I was standing all alone against the world outside. I was searching for a place to hide. Lost and lonely, now you've given me the will to survive. When I'm home, sometimes my fears get hard to hide. This world is dying right before my eyes. Now I found you, there's no more emptiness inside. When I'm hungry, your love keeps me alive. I have died with you up on Calvary's mountain. Jesus, there's nothing I wouldn't do for you. Now I've found you, there's no more emptiness inside. When I'm hungry, your love keeps me alive. Lost and lonely, now you've given me the will to survive. And when I'm hungry, your love keeps me alive. And when I'm hungry, your love keeps me alive. Keeps me alive. You're getting older and colder in spite of the coming end. You still reject Jesus, the Savior, and still the sinner's friend. He left the glory, lived and died, God's story of love for him. How can you just walk away when today is the day of salvation? You've heard it all, still you won't heed God's calling to you again. You plan to believe and receive Christ, but really can't say when. He bore the shame and your blame as he hung there in misery. How can you just walk away when today is the day of salvation? Than when you weren't even on light scene. But if you walk away today, you'll have forever to scream about what might have been. Why not surrender? Remember, you don't have that long to live. He was punished for your sin. Forgiveness is freely His to give. He left the glory, lived and died, God's story of love for you. How can you just walk away? Because now is the day of salvation. He knew you then when you weren't even on life's scene. But if you walk away today, you will have forever to scream about what might have been. Why not surrender? Remember, you don't have that long to live. He was punished for your sin. Forgiveness is freely His to give. He left the glory, lived and died, God's story of love for you. How can you just walk away? Because now is the day of salvation. Please don't just walk away, because now is the day of salvation.
The last song that you may have noticed, one of the lines was, "Why not surrender? Remember, you don't have that long to live." And that's very true. Doesn't matter if we live to be 120, which is not likely to happen, it's not very long. And I'll be 72 in May, May 22nd, receiving gifts till August the 1st, I might add. But time goes by very quickly. And we live in Midtown Toronto, Claudette and I. And for a number of months, maybe even years, I would go door to door. And I would say to the people when they would knock on the, when they would open the door, I'd say, "I'm not a politician. I don't want your vote. I'm not selling anything. I don't want your money." I said, "I'm a Christian and I'm just asking for 2 minutes of your time." And if I saw any hesitation, I would say, "I've also got a 30-second version." And there were a few people that turned down the 2-minute version, but occasionally I had to resort to the 30-second version. And this is what I would say to them. I'd say, "This little piece of paper represents your life and mine. Remember, why not surrender? Remember, you don't have that long to live." And I would say to them, "Well, this little piece of paper represents our lives. And there's a verse in the Bible. And you know, I kept waiting for somebody to freak out when they would hear me refer to the Bible. Nobody did. I say, there's a verse in the Bible that says, what is your life? It is just a vapor. It's here for a short time and then vanishes away. That's how quickly it comes and goes. And if you are living for this life and this time, you will have all eternity to regret it. Why not let God intervene in your life? He left the glory, lived and died, God's story of love for you. How can you just walk away when today is the day of salvation?" That's the last song. Well, now we come to the really good parts where here I am, I'm broke and brokenhearted, except the Lord has raised me up to a new start. I was a Christian and I knew it all along. This was not a case of getting saved. This was a case of a prodigal son being restored to fellowship with his father and the father's people. And I'm looking around this house now with very little food. And I won't even tell you how little. You wouldn't believe it if I told you. And what I can say, though, is that I'm probably one of very few people who knows the sound of a refrigerator motor as you unplug it from the wall. Why keep a refrigerator if there's no food in it? I can still remember that sound, and I thought, man, you've really hit the bottom. And just then, I was in Montreal. Dave phones from Toronto. He says, "Gary," he says, "Ward Air, Some of you will remember Ward Air. He said, Ward Air has just called and is asking us to do a couple of weeks on the Jupiter cruise ship, Greek cruise ship in the Mediterranean Sea. Are we interested? And my first thought was, cruise ship. They have food on those cruise ships, don't they? And so away we went. I got on the flight at Mirabel, north of Montreal, and off we went to Athens. We got on the cruise ship and started to do our thing, singing. It was hard work. I mean, they worked us really hard. Over the 2 weeks, we had to perform three nights, 20 minutes a night, and that's it. Three 20-minute shows for 2 weeks. So it was pretty sweet. Meanwhile, the rest of the time, we're just passengers. Well, that gave me opportunity to act as a tourist to go to Jerusalem when the ship, it didn't land at Haifa. It anchored off of Haifa, Israel, excuse me. And I took the bus trip, I'd say down, geographically it was south. But then as we were getting closer to Jerusalem, the guide said, as we make our way up to Jerusalem. And I sat there and I remembered, of course, this is the city set on the hill. This is Jerusalem. This is not a Hollywood set. This is the real place. Well, my heart really began to thrill, especially when I went to where the Lord Jesus Christ was crucified. Now, I've had people on the street say to me, yeah, how do you know that was the place? I say, look, man, hey, I don't care if it's 2 feet that way or 200 yards that way. It was close enough for me. And I stood there and I thought, Lord, how have you done this? How do you do this? You intervene in this life of mine that it has dishonored you. And now you're stirring my soul for you. You've convinced me that I need to get out of this racket known as the music business. I have no idea what the future holds. If I walk away from this, what'll I do? Go back to flying? I have no idea what the future holds, but I'm trusting you. And I stood there at the place where the Lord Jesus was crucified and was overwhelmed with the verse where Paul, the apostle, says, the Son of God loved me and gave himself for me. Now that's substitution. That's the innocent dying for the guilty. The perfect dying for the imperfect. And I was really enthused spiritually. In fact, I remember that night as the cruise ship left Haifa and sailed away from Israel, I was on the back deck. And the flag was flying, I can still remember it. And I thought, we're on stage tonight. We're singing tonight. It's one of the three nights. But my heart was in Jerusalem. My thoughts were there at the place called Calvary. And that night, now I was like a robot. I could go for months, every night, singing 2-3 hours a night and never miss a word. But that night I was missing words and skipping. And Dave's kind of wondering, what's with you? It's because even as I was on the stage that night, on that Greek cruise ship out in the Mediterranean, it was beautiful. My thoughts were still back at the place called Calvary. And so on that cruise ship, it turned out that one of the border pilots that flew us there was a fellow I had flown with. And I still remember the day he said to me, I'm walking down one of the hallways on the ship towards the lounge. It was the middle of the day or so. And he says, oh, Gary, let me introduce you to one of our girls. And along the other way comes this girl. And the first thing I noticed about her was that she was rather low size, short, vertically challenged. And he introduced me to Claudette de Gagné. And we had, a chat, and it was, our first conversation was about politics to do with Quebec and Canada. That's back in the 70s when things were a little on the hot side. They're still on the hot side. And I thought, this is an unusual young lady here. And so I kind of, you know, saw her and heard about her. She identified herself as a Christian. She had been saved a year and a half before. So she was living for the Lord on that ship. And after the so-called church service, you know, that was strange church service, one of the other entertainers said that he was going to sing a hymn. And he stood up and sang, "Oh, Danny Boy." And that was his idea of a hymn. But after that church service, I saw this young lady, Claudette de Gagne, standing at the door and waving and smiling. And I was rather delighted that she was waving and smiling at me, or so I thought. So I walked up and went over to her and engaged her in conversation, only to discover she was waving at the person beside me, the mother of one of her friends. Now, I had been praying to the Lord, specifically, "Lord, I'm so out of touch with Christian circles. I don't know any Christian girls. I know that you're preparing me for Christian marriage, but I'm going to have to trust you, because if I'm going to marry a Christian, she needs to be a new Christian and a flight attendant or a nurse." And people wonder why. I say, well, a new Christian, because I was coming back to the Lord. I didn't need some spiritual giant that would perhaps make me feel like a spiritual pygmy. And she had to be a flight attendant or a nurse because she would understand the crazy hours that I was used to keeping, up all night and sleep most of the day, kind of like a skunk or a raccoon. And so that day when I engaged her at the door there, we went out on the deck and we were somewhere between Patmos and Mykonos. And I knew she was a Christian. She had told me that. And I thought, well, I need to find out what kind of church she goes to. So I said to her, "Well, what church is this you go to in Toronto?" And she said, "Well, I'm a new Christian." Boom. I already knew she was a flight attendant. I already knew she was a Christian. But when she said, "I'm a new Christian," I realized right there, the Lord was saying, "You asked me for a new Christian who was a flight attendant or a nurse. She's telling you she's a new Christian." I didn't know what to do. I said, "Lord, not so soon. I didn't mean like so soon." Well, a wonderful romance that spanned three continents, as one family friend said, came along, and we found ourselves a year and a half later being married on January the 19th. And we've just celebrated our 42nd anniversary. And there's the wedding photo for you. In a bygone day, a younger man, a thinner man. And while we're at it, I want to just show you Vera. Remember Vera, my grandmother, who was an unwed mother, gave birth to my mother, who, and you've heard the story. Here they are together in later life. Vera on the, I guess it's the left with the white hair, and Pearly on the right, my mother. There they are in lovely days and times. And Claudette and I began a life together. After all we'd been through, I an only child, she the second eldest of 14 children. Imagine. And you know, she trusted the Lord and became a Christian on the island of Fiji in the South Pacific the first time she ever heard the gospel. In fact, she had friends in her hometown who were Christians, and when she began to witness to them, thinking they were unsaved and needed the gospel, they said, "Oh, well, we're Christians." And she said, "Well, why didn't you ever tell me this?" She said, "Well, you know how hard some religious people are to witness to." She said, no, it wasn't hard at all. Because the young man who witnessed to her bore such a testimony, and the Holy Spirit worked, and the Lord saved Claudette de Gagne on the island of Fiji. And so we began our new life together in January of 1980. I had gone back to flying by that time and was now a civil aviation inspector with Transport Canada, which was quite interesting. And the Lord intervened again there and used circumstances in that job to lead me out of that job and out of aviation and lead us into missionary work Claudette was already heading for missionary work in her own heart when she met me. She took a bit of a chance, but she was trusting the Lord, because I could have been a terrible distraction, distracting her away from missionary work that the Lord had called her to. She had a heart to go to Japan. Now, she got to Japan, all right. We're coming to that. But 2 years after we were married, the Lord again pulled some cards out of my comfortable, cozy, very lucrative government position where the sky was the limit, so to speak, within the government, and said, okay, enough of this. I have a whole new life for you and Claudette. Well, I want to tell you, next to being saved and perhaps meeting Claudette, that was the biggest shock of my life. It's like I said, Lord, just a minute now. Do you know what you're doing? Do you realize who you're saying this to? Like, I am the least likely candidate. I'm the least worthy to, until he reminded me, it's not about you, Gary. It's not about your worthiness. It's about me. And I have been leading you. I've intervened. I've salvaged your life from the scrap heap. I've got you back on your feet. I've blessed you by answering your prayer for this marvelous wife. And now we've got a new chapter coming up for you here. And, you know, the Lord took us into his work as of August the 1st, 1982. And that's the night Gene McClellan sang that song. What a way to begin the incarnation of the great I Am. That sold me on that song when I heard that. In the intervening years, before we went to Ireland, and I must backtrack a bit and say that while we were still engaged, I wrote a song for Claudette. I had written lots of songs, but I wanted to write a very special song for her. And on Thanksgiving weekend of the October before the January where we got married, we went for a walk in the forest, beautiful setting. Talk about staging, God's staging. And I sat down on some kind of a log or tree stump and sang a song to her called My Life, My Love, and My All. And when I finished, I thought maybe there'd be a tear or two, not a chance. She said, you shouldn't be singing those words to me. Those words are only fitting for the Lord. And you know, she was right. She's still right. That's quite true. But tonight, you're going to hear the original version. But when we recorded it last week, Doug and I added one word. I changed one word, which updates the song from October of 1979 to today. Doug said, bring us up to date. There's one word in the song. It's towards the end of the song, which updates the song completely. But it's a song that Claudette rightly said should be sung only to the Lord. And then after that, there'll be an Irish song. So here is the original version of My Life, My Love, My All.
What did I do to deserve the kind of love I found in you? What can I give you in return, my love, my life, my love, and my all? What can I say? It's hard to speak. You know you take my breath away. I've always dreamt about the joy I know today. My life, my love, and my all. And all my life I've waited for this song, yeah. to love you more than love myself. You've taught me how to really care, and I want to share my life with you. Ooh, I really love you. It's all been said before, but I'll say it all again. It's hard to speak, you know, you take my breath away. I've always dreamt about the joy I feel today. My love and my all. You're my life, my love and my all. You're my wife, my love and my. Come to the Savior, where life in its fullness is free. And let him forgive you and save you the way he saved me. He'll bring peace to your soul, and he'll make you his very own son. Then he'll give you a mansion forever when this life is done. Come to the Savior who hangs on Calvary's hill, and look upon. Died there your debt to fulfill, and let his blood cleanse you from all of your bondage to sin. And how happy you'll be when the peace of Jesus comes in. To the Savior who waits with arms open wide. He welcomes his sheepfold and welcomes each lost sheep inside. And whatever your guilt and your shame, you can leave it behind, because Jesus took all of your sins on the cross when he died. Come to the Savior where life in its fullness is free.
Did you catch the word? It rhymes with life. I said, you're my wife. Claudette does not prefer me to sing that version because she quite rightly knows it should be directed to the Lord. Just an update. This is a picture of my mother the first year she was saved. She's a brand new Christian here. She's 26 years of age. Pearl. Well, because of time, we're going to have to really contract things here. But the Lord took us to Ireland in 1986. We served him in Toronto for 4 years, which was wonderful because it introduced me to street work. And I'd love to tell you about the first time I was sitting around ready to go preaching downtown at Young and Bloor, and nobody else showed up, and I was the only one. And I said, "Well, Lord, I guess can't go. There's nobody else here." And he said, "Well, I'm here." "Well, yeah, but I go alone." "Well, no. You see, you'll never be alone, Gary. So let's go. It's you and me. Let's go." Well, some other time I'll tell you what God did that day. Absolutely amazing. And it was God's way of preparing me for working alone in the mission field, which includes Ireland. Well, I've got to read the list. Greece, Japan, Macau, Hong Kong, Singapore, and Beijing. The Claudette was with me all of those places and very often on the streets with me. I'd love to tell you about the day that I asked her to come to the front of a large crowd in Ireland, in the town of Tralee, large crowd, and I asked her to come and give her testimony. And many of the ladies in the front rows were weeping because of the tenderness with which she spoke to them. So this street work is not me out there as some kind of lone wolf maverick. It's me out there with the Lord, and Claudette, as able, she's got other ministries, many other ministries, and one of my favorites is this one. It's called the Ministry of Hospitality. Tremendous cook, unbelievable. I had no idea that that was part of the package of the new Christian flight attendant. And one of our favorite foods is calamari. We went to Greece several times and had a wonderful month in Greece as an evangelist working with a team. And that's another story, but you really should hear it sometime about how God uses a non-Greek speaker. They said, "Well, we need people who aren't Greeks because the Greek Orthodox priests don't want the people listening to people who were Greek Orthodox and now they're heretics. So if you come along and you preach and we translate for you, then the people can rationalize and say they're not really listening to the translator who is a heretic in their minds. They're listening to the English guy who doesn't know any better, the English speaker." And they said, "That's how we train our preachers, by having them translate at first." Well, we worked with this family, Kostas and Elke McLeese, 17 years in the jungles of Irian Jaya before they had to come back for health reasons to Greece. And what a ministry, Hellenic Ministries, fantastic. And if you're feeling a bit peckish after this program is over, you can go and find yourself a piece of squid or octopus somewhere, and that'll give you some nightmares probably, or maybe sweet dreams. Just a few words about why did we spend so much time in our 60s in Japan, Macau, Hong Kong, Singapore, Beijing? Well, it began with our youngest son, who's a pilot, and he ended up going to Asia and flying for various companies around Asia. And in each case, Claudette and I were given a free return ticket to and from Asia once a year. Well, then we were, through Harold Summers, we were introduced to the assemblies in Singapore, and they began to fly us over a couple of times here and there to speak at conferences and so on and so forth. And I don't know why they would, fly someone like me over, Harold for that matter. They're loaded with gift. But they told me one day when I asked them, they said, "The Lord used Western missionaries to bring the gospel to us, and we bring you men over from time to time to remind us of our roots." I thought that was very touching. Because they certainly don't need us. But all this is to say that over the course of 10 years, we were probably in Asia about 12 times. During those years, we were teaching English as a second language using the Bible only to young Asians, mostly Japanese. And that led to lots of reunions back in Japan and teaching at the Tokyo Assembly, one of the assemblies in Tokyo. That's another amazing story. You really need to hear about how God intervened and saved a lady because of meeting her on a subway platform in Tokyo, that would have been Osaka. Tokyo, I'm thinking. Totally amazing. And Claudette heard from her at Christmas, as she often does. But let me just say a word or two about one of the trips to Beijing, and this will lead into the last two songs. Beijing. Well, if you're going to go to another country, you need one of these. That's a passport. But for countries like China, you need more than just this, a passport. You need a visa, a thing called a visa. And there's a visa that the Chinese government, with all the trappings, it was issued in 2016, and it's good till the 11th of March, 2024. And it's good for 90-day entries. At the time, it was good for 10 entries. And we used several, and this, you can see the stamp in there. But why am I mentioning the passport? Well, because, you see, a lot of people have the mistaken notion that they're just going to die. And then, by the way, that's not a mistaken notion. The dying part is not a mistaken notion. That's a real thing. You are going to die. It is appointed unto man once to die, and after this, the judgment. But many people have the mistaken notion that they're going to die and end up before God saying, well, I should come into heaven because I'm this and I that and I this and I don't do this and I this. You're going to start talking about yourself before God. Let me tell you, that's not going to happen. If you die without Christ, you're going to be eternity without Christ. And when it comes to the great white throne judgment, which is the second death, you will say nothing. You'll be silent and every mouth will be stopped. You'll not be there to plead your case. You'll be there for the judge of heaven and earth to roll out the evidence of your sin and your guilt before casting you into the lake of fire in the second death. That's the bad news. But the good news is so good because the bad news is so bad. The Lord Jesus Christ is God's way to God's heaven. It doesn't matter what you say, think, or do, you will not enter God's sovereign heaven without his son as your savior. Can you imagine? I waltz up to the immigration people in China and they say, where's a passport? I don't have one, but I love Chinese food. Oh, dim sum. Give me some dim sum. Okay. We need a passport. Well, I can speak Chinese. I can speak Mandarin and Cantonese. And my son is married to a, that's all very nice, but passport, please. Okay, oh yeah, here's my passport. Where's the visa? You see, I don't show up at their, on their soil and tell them the terms of entry into their sovereign territory. Not a chance. They tell me what the requirements are. And if I comply, I am received in, I'm welcomed in to the country. Our passports are full of stamps of various countries around the world. And everywhere we go, it's the same. You must adhere to the entrance requirements of those sovereign nations. Well, listen, is heaven any different? Of course not. And God requires you must have the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, the one in whom you have put your trust, the one in whom you have recognized that he loved you, he gave himself for you, that he bore your sin in his own body on the tree. If you do not come to God's heaven, God's way, you will not come any other way. There is no other way. Jesus is the only way. Well, here am I with Daniel on a train going south of Beijing one day, and I've got a suitcase on my lap and the fellow beside me. I thought, nobody would speak English on this train. But all of a sudden, this fellow, youngish man, he says in very good English, he said, you might be more comfortable with that suitcase under your seat. Oh, I thought, good. He speaks great English. So I'm thinking, Lord, need some help here. How do I start to speak about your son to a man in China on a train south of Beijing? Where do I start? Well, I thought, let's do what New Tribes people do. They start at the beginning, from creation to Christ. So I said to him, I got chatting with him. He showed me his business card. His name was Zhao Lin. He was a manager of a chemical company in Beijing, had a master of business degree, smart guy. He was on his way to visit his aging parents in a town south of Beijing, 33 years of age, very approachable. I said, Zhao, I said, I went to a university to start to do a master of business, didn't finish it, did something else. But I said, tell me, where does everything come from? The moon, the stars, the planet, the mountains, the sea, the fish, the animals, the birds. Where did everything come from, Zhao? And he said, oh, we are taught not to think about this problem. Did you hear that? He said, we are taught not to think about this problem. We are taught not to think about this problem. That was a fantastic opening. So I said to him, well, Zhao, when you were doing your MBA courses, did you learn about problems? Yes. I said, did they teach you how to solve business problems, or did they teach you how to not think about these problems? He said, oh, no. They teach us how to solve these problems. I said, well, let me help you understand how to solve this problem. You've called it a problem, and it is a problem, because you need to know the creator who created everything. And I said, let me tell you about this God, this creator. And he says, I am too busy to think about this problem. And I thought, oh, so this is the way people in China think. They're taught not to think about this problem, and they're too busy to think about this problem. And it wasn't long before I realized that's exactly the way people in Canada think. They're taught systematically by this education system and everything else. They're taught not to think about life after death. And that's a big problem, the biggest problem you'll ever have. And then, of course, people are too busy to think about this problem. But tonight, I implore you to think about this problem and to consider your latter end, because death is coming. It is coming, tick tock, tick tock, 1 second at a time. You and I are many ticks and tocks closer to eternity now than when we first began here tonight. And you have no idea the danger you're in. This is what we live our lives for, is seeking to interrupt people's lives with thoughts of eternity. This is a bypath meadow, a Vanity Fair of a world, politically, entertainment-wise, sports-wise, in every way. Everything seems to be designed to keep people from thinking about where they will be for eternity. Did you know that you will not spend eternity in heaven or in hell? Christians will not spend eternity in heaven. And unsaved people will not spend eternity in hell. You see, you can spend your money, you can spend your holidays, and one day you will spend your life. It'll be spent, gone, finished, used up. But you will never, ever spend eternity. As death finds you, eternity will hold you. And where you land 1 second after death is where you will stay. You will never spend eternity. Now, that is a frightening thought if you're not a believer here tonight. It's a joyous thought if you are saved, man or woman, boy or girl. So shall we ever be with the Lord, says Paul. I conclude with this. In Beijing with Dan, son Daniel, we stayed in a hostel, rather nice hostel, the first three floors of a large hotel. But I got there a day or so early to sleep off some jet lag. And the young people around the hostel were bustling about doing things and scurrying about. And the music was playing. It was all in Chinese. Of course, I didn't understand any of it. But all of a sudden, a song came on. And the young people didn't stop what they were doing, but they all sang along with it word for word. And I stood and I watched. And I thought, I don't know what that song is saying, but it's a very tender song, and it's obviously touched the hearts of these young people. I suspect it's a love song, and that was the case. Turns out it was a love song called Last Kiss. But I rewrote the words to it. I took the music and put new words to it. And that's the next song you're going to hear. And it's called Trust Me With Your Heart.
Hiding from your sin and shame, trying to forget, but you can't again. Walking down a crowded street, listening to your own heartbeat. Like so many people, you're battered, bruised, and sore. Your questions could be answered if you bring them to the Lord. And trust Him with your heart, trust Him with your soul. Take Him by the hand, He won't let go. He'll show you what His love is if you haven't got a clue. He'll show you that His promises are true. But you say nothing lasts forever, we're only here today. Believe me now or never, can you hear Jesus say, trust me with your heart, trust me with your soul. Give me your hand, I'll hold you, I'll show you what my love is. I'll be your guiding star, believe me and trust me with your heart. Blood-drenched cross, dying to deliver you from endless loss. Where you're gonna find someone to do for you what He has done? If you're living without Jesus, you'll die without Him too. He cried out, it is finished, now there's nothing more to do. But trust Him with your heart, trust Him with your soul. Take Him by the hand, He won't let go. He'll show you what His love is if you haven't got a clue. Show you that His promises are true. If you say nothing lasts forever, we're only here today. Believe Him now or never. Do you hear Jesus say, trust me with your heart, trust me with your soul. Give me your hand, I'll hold you, I'll show you what my love is. I'll be your guiding star, believe me. Trust me with your heart, trust me with your soul. Give me your hand, I'll hold you, I'll show you what my love is. I'll be your guiding star, believe me. Receive me and trust me with your heart. Believe me and trust me with your heart. Never give up the fight. Don't let the devil win. He'd love to take you with him to the pit of hell, but you don't belong to him. Never give up the fight. Keep on swinging for the souls of men, preaching sin and righteousness and judgment, 'cause Jesus is coming back again. Never give up the fight. Hell is real and eternity's long. Never give up the fight. Fight on. Never give up the fight. You never have to fight alone. Jesus said, go into all the world, and lo, I'm with you always. But don't give up. Never give up the fight. Never give up the fight. Don't let the devil win. He's taking many millions to the flames of hell, 'cause they still belong to him. Never give up the fight. Keep on swinging for the souls of men. Preach Christ crucified up on Calvary's hill for whosoever will. Never give up the fight. Hell is real and eternity's oh so long. Never give up the fight. Fight on. Never give up the fight. You never have to fight alone, 'cause Jesus said go into all the world, and know I'm with you always. But don't give up. Never give up the fight. Never give up the fight. Don't give up. Never give up the fight. The devil would love you to quit, but never give up the fight.
So the fight that's being referred to is the good fight. God's looking for men and women to fight for him, not go around punching people, but to fight the good fight of faith, which is simply taking God at his word. God says it, we rest in what the word of God says because of who said it. And the word of God is from the God of the word. They are inseparable. So I thank you so much for hanging in with us here this evening. And also I want to thank all the folks at Greenwood Gospel Chapel, our dear brothers and sisters. We love you all. Good night, everyone.
We want to thank you for joining us. This is our February hug to you. So we want to say happy Valentine's Day and send our love and our hugs out to each one of you.